All right, you're good. Well, hang on. Now you're good.
Straight up.
Now you're good.
Yes. On your college graduation, and she graduated from Campbell, went from one creek to the other, didn't go to Campbell, right? She got her degree in Bachelor of Science and Health and Sports Science, right? Graduated cum laude, which that means she done really well, right? She had good grades.
How about that?
And in January, she will begin graduate school at Campbell for her doctorate in physical therapy. Kathy said, if I'm going to get Campbell, that's going for your second hump, is what they say. Yeah. Well, Lane, we're proud of you on your graduation. And I know your mom and dad are proud of you. So we've got this devotion we're going to give you. We didn't quite get it wrote in yet, so we're going to, Miss Lori is going to write in, and we'll give it back to you. Okay? But just use this and God's word, and you go forward.
Congratulations on graduating. I think that's a great, great accomplishment. I remember took me 16 years to get to my master's. And I know how happy it is when you get through and now you're getting ready to go back into it a lot deeper. So, but congratulations, and we are all very proud of you. You're a breath, a fresh air here, and so we love you, okay? And, hello, and happy birthday. I'm so happy that you made it 7.
And I'm so happy I invited you to my birthday.
Well, thank you so much for inviting me to your birthday. I hope you invited me. I was your dad, so, or am. I don't know what all this past tense talk is, but I am your dad. I am your father. So, the baby was born 2 days ago, right? Or was it last night or 2 days ago? Friday. Yeah, Friday. Nice. Good. I'm happy for you. I'm happy for you. Congratulations. They lose attention. Gosh, you turn the air off. It's starting to get warm in here. No, I'm kidding. It gets really hot when you're standing up here. So for some reason, it just, I guess all the eyes looking at you, it puts the heat on you. But yes, kind of warm, nice warm day. Hey. Well, it is good to be in the house of the Lord today. I'm so thankful for you coming. I am looking forward to studying God's Word with you in Hebrews. I'm looking forward to telling you what I've studied and what I've learned. Again, it is something that that we should be doing as a people of God, to know who God is, to know why He did what He did, and to know why we need a Savior. And so, throughout the history of time, God has spoken to the world. Throughout history. And we're going to see that. And now, we can always go back to Hebrews 1. And we says here, in Hebrews 1:1, God, after He spoke long ago to the fathers, in the prophets, in many portions and in many ways, in these last days has spoken to us in His Son, whom He appointed heir of all things, through whom also He made the world. We see that Christ is God. But most of all, what we see here is that God has spoken to us. Now, I want to take us back. All right? I want to take us back to the Garden of Eden. Okay? When God created the Garden of Eden, right? He created the earth. He created the space and everything that's in it. Everything that we see in this world has been created by God. And it happened in 7 days. 6 days of creation, 7th day, a Sabbath rest. But He created it all. He even created the Sabbath for us. And so what we see here is that when He created all things, and then He creates man on the 6th day. And He places man in God's rest. Okay? He places man in the Garden of Eden. And after He places him, the next day, He creates the Sabbath day. And this is the Sabbath day of rest. This is the day that He rests. He rests from all His works. From creation, from creating man, creating planets, creating space and time and everything. He rests from His works. And man was in the Garden of Eden, placed in the Garden of Eden. He didn't have to do anything. He didn't have to do anything. All his food was provided for him. God provided everything for Adam and Eve. They were in rest with God. They had a relationship with one another. They walked with God. It says that Adam walked with God in the cool of the evening. And so they had this rest together. And Adam did not have a care in the world. He did not have a want. Because he was taken care of by God. Everything that he needed, God provided. But then, God says, every tree you can eat of, every fruit you can eat of, except for this one tree. Do not eat of this tree, for when you eat of this tree, you will surely die. And that was a promise. That was a promise. That was something that God had said. And when he says something about something that will happen, that is a promise that will happen. If you eat of this tree, you will surely die. And what happens? He eats of the tree. Him and Eve, they eat of the tree. But it's not so much of them eating of the tree, it's what happened in their hearts before they took that bite. Before they bit that fruit of knowledge of good and evil, their hearts had already turned. Their hearts had already turned from God. They now disbelieved God. They did not believe what he said. They did not believe that he was going to take care of them. They thought that he was going to, that he's keeping something from them. And this was all done by the temptation of Satan, telling them, look, he's trying to keep something from you. I mean, because he knows that if you eat of this tree, you will be like him, knowing good and evil. You know, he doesn't love you. He's not going to provide for you. He's not going to take care of you. And so in their hearts, they started believing the lie. Now imagine, you've got everything. You were at total rest. You have no need for anything. And yet someone comes in and leads you astray. But it all started here in your heart. It started here. And so what happens? They're cursed. The ground is cursed. Earth is cursed. Satan has been, there's a prophecy that's put on Satan that the Savior will come and crush his head, but Satan will bruise his heel. That there is a Savior coming, but God made an atonement for them. He killed an animal, and he covered them with their skin. And then he did something that was quite amazing. He threw them out of the barn. He threw them out of the rest of God. And now they are laboring. They are laboring for their own salvation, their own righteousness. I mean, think about it. The first thing that they did, think about this now. The first thing that they did when they sinned against God was they began to labor. How? Well, they gathered up these fig leaves and they started to sew them together to cover themselves up because of their shame. Their shame. And so they're like, how do we hide this shame that we have? And so what they do is they begin to labor to make themselves righteous. And so they labor to cover themselves up, to cover up their shame. But God said, no, 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 it ain't going to work that way. It ain't going to work that way. You're not going to be able to cover up your shame. There's nothing that you can do to correct this situation. I have to do it. But first, I have to throw you out of my rest. And so from the beginning of time, from that moment, he has been proclaiming the rest of God. That he is offering to the world, he's offering to the people a rest, to come back to the rest. And so Hebrews chapter 4 is talking about this rest. And let's read. It says, therefore, let us fear while a promise remains of entering his rest. any one of you may seem to have come short of. So again, the writer of Hebrews, he's talking to a church of Jews, probably. There is a group of people who are firm believers. There is a group of people who are riding the fence and want to stay with the Judaism practices and sacrifices, and they think it's Jesus plus something else. And then there are those who don't believe at all. They don't trust at all. And it's just like the church that we live in today. There are wheat and there are tares. There are people that are connected to the vine, but they're not living in the vine. They're not abiding in the vine. And those people will be cut off on the last day and thrown into the fire. It's a hard reality, but that's what's happening here as well. And so what you see here, it says, therefore. What is that? So when we see a therefore, we jump back up, we go back a little bit and say, okay, what are we talking about here? And so we're talking about, so we see that the Israelites were unable to enter into Canaan, a promised land, because of their unbelief. Because of their unbelief, they were unable to enter into the Canaan land. The land that was promised to Abraham. The land that was promised to the Israelite tribes. This was a land that God says, when you come in here, you will not have to work and labor. The houses that you need will already be built for you. The vineyards will be there for you. The crops will be there for you. And all you have to do is enter into my rest. Canaan was a picture of what was to come. Canaan was a picture of that rest that we have in God. That reconciliation where God abides with us. But what happened? What happened? Let's turn to Numbers 14. Numbers 14. Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers. And let's read the story real quick. Then all the congregation lifted up their voices and cried, and the people wept that night. And the sons of Israel grumbled against Moses and Aaron. The whole congregation said to them, would that we had died in the land of Egypt, or would that we had died in this wilderness. Why is the Lord bringing us into this land to fall by the sword? So they get all the way up to the land of Canaan, and they send these spies out. And these spies go, and they look at the land. 10 spies come back and say, oh, they're giants. They're huge. There's no way we can defeat these people. And then you've got Joshua and Caleb, the other two spies that come back, and they say, we can defeat them. God is with us. Let's do it. And so they see this, and the people start grumbling. So they say to one another, let us appoint a leader to return to Egypt. This is what they wanted to do. They want to go back to slavery. They want to go back to slavery. It says, then Moses and Aaron fell on their faces in the presence of all the assembly of the congregation of the sons of Israel. Joshua, the son of Nun, and Caleb, the son of Jephunneh, of those who had spied out the land, tore their clothes. They ripped their clothes. So you've got Aaron and Moses falling on the ground on their faces, and Joshua and Caleb ripping their clothes and saying, you guys, why can't you wake up? God is on our side. Where is your faith? And they spoke to all the congregations of the Son of Israel saying, the land which we pass through to spy out is an exceedingly good land. If the Lord is pleased with us, then he will bring us into this land and give it to us. A land which flows with milk and honey. Only do not rebel against the Lord, and do not fear the people of the land, for they will be our prey. Their protection has been removed from them, and the Lord is with us. Do not fear them. But all the congregation said to stone them with stones. They were going to stone Moses and Aaron and Joshua and Caleb for trusting in the Lord, for believing that they could take over this land. They were going to stone them with stones, and the glory of the Lord appeared in the tent of meeting to all the sons of Israel. All of a sudden, God comes down, and he appears to them, and the Lord said to Moses, how long will this people spurn me, and how long will they not believe in me? Despite all the signs which I have performed in their midst, I will smite them with pestilence, and dispossess them, and I will make you into a nation greater and mightier than they. But Moses said to the Lord, then the Egyptians will hear of it. By your strength you brought these people from their midst. And they will tell it to the inhabitants of this land, that they have heard that you, O Lord, are in the midst of this people. For you, O Lord, are seen eye to eye. While your cloud stands over them, and you go before them in a pillar of cloud by day and a pillar of fire at night. Now, if you slay this people as one man, then the nations who you have heard, who have heard of your name, of your fame, will say, because the Lord should not bring this people into the land which he promised them by oath, therefore he slaughtered them in the wilderness. But now I pray, let the power of the Lord be great, just as you have declared. The Lord is slow to anger and abundant in loving kindness, forgiving iniquity and transgressions. But he will by no means clear the guilty, visiting the iniquity of the fathers on the children to the third and fourth generations. Does that sound familiar? Does that sound familiar to you? Those who have been going through John, and we see the glorification of God, this is God's name. This is his nature. This is who he is. When he passed by Moses, he proclaimed. So Moses is saying, look, you are a God of compassion. You are a God of abundant loving kindness, slow to anger. He's reminding God. Of course, God doesn't need to be reminded of who he is. But Moses needs to be reminded. And so Moses is saying, but you're a God of loving, of compassion and loving kindness, forgiving iniquity and transgressions. He says, pardon, I pray, the iniquity of this people, according to the greatness of your loving kindness, just as you also have forgiven this people from Egypt even until now. So the Lord said, I pardon them according to your word, but indeed as I live, all the earth will be filled with the glory of God. Surely all the men whom you've seen, who have seen my glory and my signs, which I performed in Egypt and in the wilderness, yet have put me to the test these 10 times, have not listened to my voice. There it is. God spoke. God spoke. And they have not listened. They have not listened to me. I have spoken. I have said, you can have rest, and they will not believe. They will not believe me. I have spoken. They will not listen to my voice. Shall by no means see the land which I swore to their fathers, nor shall any of those who spurn me see it. So they all died in the wilderness. They all died in the wilderness. Well, that generation died. And so what happened was the generation that came up behind them got to go into the land. Got to go into the land of rest, of promise. But the problem here, the problem with that, they go into the rest, and what do they do? What do? They start turning. They turn their backs against God, and they start worshiping other gods, false idols. They create these high places that they go up to, and they worship Ashtaroth. They worship all these gods that are part of the land. instead of expelling all these gods, they turned their backs on gods and they said, we don't believe you. We don't trust you. But here's the thing. It says, therefore, and we talked about that, because of their unbelief, they dropped in the wilderness. They were dead in the wilderness. That generation that saw all the signs of God for 40 years dropped dead in the wilderness. And that generation behind them were the ones who got to come in. And he says, therefore, let us fear. And this is he talking to the church here. This is talking to the people who were in the church, who were not believers. Because believers shouldn't fear. Believers have a confidence. And we'll talk about that. But I want you to know that what he's addressing here is those who need to fear. Those who need to fear. He said, therefore, let us fear while a promise remains of entering his rest. That promise that he made from the very beginning of time is still available to you today. It's still available to you today. Those who are hearing this on the internet or anything of that nature here in this place, rest is offered to you today. And he says, any one of you may seem to have come short of it. He says, fear unbelief. Because if you are an unbeliever, you come short. You are here, you hear the gospel constantly, you hear this offer of rest constantly, and all of a sudden, one day Christ comes, and you've fallen short because of your unbelief. Any one of you may seem to have come short of it. Verse 2. For indeed we have had good news preached to us. Yes, we have had good news preached to us. It has been preached to us. This church has had the good news preached to it. This world has had the good news preached to it. The good news of Jesus Christ. The good news of coming into the rest of God. To be reconciled with God through Jesus Christ. That is the good news. That he rose from the dead so that you can have eternal life. That is the good news. Let's find out what the good news is here. I say it. Let's see what the Bible says. Romans chapter 1, verse 1. Paul, a bondservant of Jesus Christ, called as an apostle, set apart for the gospel of God. He has been set apart for the gospel of God, to preach the gospel, the good news of Jesus Christ. He says, which he promised beforehand through his prophets in the Holy Scriptures. There it is right there. God spoke to the fathers through the prophets. So he's saying, which he promised. He promised beforehand through his prophets in the Holy Scriptures. And here it is, concerning his son. Let's consider Jesus. Does that sound familiar? Consider Jesus. Concerning his son, who was born of a descendant of David, according to the flesh, who was declared the Son of God. There's his lordship. With the power by the resurrection from the dead. There it is right there. According to the Spirit of holiness, Jesus Christ our Lord, through whom we have received grace and apostleship to bring about the obedience of faith. We have been sent out into the world to bring people to faith. Bring people to the obedience of faith. This is a commandment that we must have faith in order to receive his rest. That's all it takes, is faith. Faith in the Son of God. Faith in our Lord Jesus Christ. Faith in that he was raised from the dead. He says, among you, among whom also you are the called of Jesus Christ. And we skip down to 16, for I'm not ashamed of the gospel, for it is the power of God for salvation to everyone, what? Who believes. The power of salvation to everyone who believes. To the Jew first and also to the Greek. For in it the righteousness of God is revealed from faith to faith. As it is written, but the righteous man shall live by faith. It's the confession that we have, that we hold on to. Remember, we hold fast to this confession that we have. What is the confession? Let's turn. Romans 10. You want to know what the confession is? Here's our confession. Romans 10, verse 8. But what does it say? The word is near you in your mouth and in your heart. That is the word of faith, which we are preaching. That, here it is, if you confess with your mouth Jesus as Lord and believe in your heart that God has raised him from the dead, you will be saved. Where are the works in that? Nowhere. Where are the works? Absolutely nowhere. What do? We believe. We confess. For with, verse 10, for with the heart a person believes, resulting in righteousness. And with the mouth he confesses, resulting in salvation. Whoever believes in him will not be disappointed. I like hearing that. Whoever believes in him, and we're not talking about, oh yes, I believe there's a God. Oh yes, I believe there was a Jesus. Oh, so that makes me okay. No. This is putting your faith in one. This is, when we say believing, we're trusting. We're trusting in his words. We're trusting in his commandments. We're obeying. Remember that old song? Trust and obey, for there's no other way to be happy in Jesus but to trust and obey. There's word, that is truth. That is truth. We don't sing much about trusting and obeying anymore. I mean, it's hard to hear any kind of music that's coming out into the world today that we are to trust him and obey him. But that is what we are supposed to do. We trust and we obey him. We obey his commandments. What was his commandment? To love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind. That is your life. You love him with all your life. You lay your life down for him. The second one is like unto it, to love your neighbor as yourself. All these are wrapped up in the Ten Commandments. But he said, look, if you want salvation, if you want salvation, here's my commandment. You have to believe in the one whom God has sent. That's what you do. Easy verse, everybody knows it, John 3:16, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believes will have eternal life and never perish. That's what it's all about, people. It's not about what you do. If you rest on your works, I'm telling you, if you rest on your works, you will be disappointed. You will be disappointed. You cannot rest on your works. You have to rest on your faith. You have to rest on your faith. That confession that you hold fast to, that Jesus is Lord, and believing in your heart that God has raised him from the dead. That's what you hold on to. Go back to Hebrews 4. He says, "For indeed we have good news preached to us." That's the good news. The gospel of Jesus Christ. "Just as they also," he's telling them, "just as they in the past have also had that good news preached to them. From the very beginning of time." Genesis 3:15, go back and look at it. That they're still in the garden, but God's laying down curses and he's laying out a plan of salvation for them. He lays out his plan of salvation to bring them back to the rest of God. And he has spoken it throughout time. He has spoken it throughout history to everyone. He said, "For indeed we have had good news preached to us, just as they also. But the word they heard did not profit them." So they hear this word preached to them, and it did not profit them, because why? It was not united by faith in those who heard. They did not trust him. They did not trust his words. So that good news was preached to them, and we've had good news preached to us. And if it's not united in faith, it's worthless to you. And Wayne will tell you this, you can give anybody a Gideon Bible, and they can have the Word of God, they can read right through it, but if it's not coupled with faith, that's a useless book to them. I can sit here and preach the Word of God to you till I'm blue in the face. But if you don't believe, it means nothing to you. If you don't have trust, if you don't believe that God has raised him from the dead, and you have laid your life down, and you have come to the cross and laid it down and said, "Forgive me of my sins," and if you have not done this, it's worthless to you to get up here and preach the gospel to you. If it's not coupled by faith. He says, "We who have," there it is, "we who have believed," and we've talked about that too, if we hold fast, right? So then he says, "For we who have believed, enter that rest." You see that? How do you enter the rest? Believe. "We who have believed, enter that rest. Just as he said, 'As I swore in my wrath, they shall not enter my rest,' although his works were finished from the foundation of the world." And that's what he's saying here. And he's getting ready to lay it out. But what he's saying here is that from the very beginning of the world, his rest has been there. From the foundation of the world, he has finished his work. He's rested, and now he's saying, "Come to my rest. Come to my rest. Come to my rest. Here's how you can come to my rest. All you have to do is believe. All you have to do is believe. Trust him. Trust him." That's it. All you have to do is believe. "Come to my rest from the foundation of the world. For he has said somewhere concerning the seventh day, 'And God rested on the seventh day from all his works.' And again, in this passage, 'They shall not enter my rest.' Therefore, since," here it is, "'it remains for some to enter it, and those who formerly had good news preached to them failed to enter because of," what? "Disobedience." So they failed to enter his rest because of disobedience, because of unbelief. Always remember, go back to the Garden of Eden. The word of God was told to Adam. And what happened? He did not believe. And he was thrown out of God's rest. But God gave him an opportunity to get back into that rest through the death of one. Through the death of one, and that is Jesus Christ. He says, therefore, since it remains, this rest is remaining. It remains. It's still here today for you to take. He says, therefore, since it remains for some to enter, and this is a promise. And here's the thing. I want you to see that. It doesn't say many, does it? It doesn't say, since it remains for many to enter, just some. It's very sad. There's a lot of people that are going to be disappointed on that day. But it remains for some to enter it, and those who formerly had good news preached to them failed to enter because of disobedience. Verse 7, he again fixes a certain day. It says, today, through David, after so long a time, just as it had been said before, today if you hear his voice, do not harden your hearts. And if Joshua had given them rest, he would not have spoken of another day after that. So there remains a Sabbath rest for the people of God. For the one who has entered his rest has himself also rested from his works, as God did from his. Therefore, let us be diligent to enter that rest, so that no one will fall through following the same example of disobedience. So what's going on here, what he's saying here, and I'm gonna condense this so you'll be able to understand what he's saying here. He's saying, throughout time, throughout history, throughout the, Moses, throughout Moses saying, there's a land for you, there's a promise for you, God speaking through Moses, he's saying, there's a land for you, I don't want that land. I don't want his promises, okay? You're dead. You're gone. Unbelief. Joshua brings the people, this new generation, into this land. This land, this beautiful land that's all supplied for them. And they turn their backs. And so what happens? The kingdom gets split. The Israel is defeated. Judea is defeated. And this is the time of Joshua. This is the time of David. See, he says he again fixes a certain day. David saying to the people, today, saying through David after so long, just as we said before, today, this is David saying, today if you hear his voice, do not harden your hearts. Do not harden your hearts. If you hear him, do not harden. Believe him. Trust him. It says that today if you hear his voice, do not harden your hearts. For if Joshua had given them rest, which he didn't, he wasn't able to give them rest because of their unbelief. The land of Canaan wasn't rest for them because of their unbelief. He says, were Joshua given rest, he would not have spoken of another day after that. So there was a day of rest that's coming. There's a day of rest that's coming. And we preach to you that those who are in Christ Jesus are in rest with God. But there is a day coming. There is a day coming when we will be in total rest, when we will cease from our labors. There is that day that's coming. I promise you that. This is the good news preached to you. This is the good news that is preached to the apostles and the prophets of old, that we preach you a coming rest, a rest that will come. But those who are in Christ Jesus now have that rest. We no longer work for our salvation. We no longer toil for our salvation. It has been given to us. He says, for one who has entered his rest has himself also rested from his works, as God did from his. God's at rest. If you are in Christ, if you believe, then you are at rest with God. So Joshua's pointing to that further day. David's pointing to that further day. The apostles are pointing to that further day and say, enter into his rest. Enter into his rest. Because that rest hasn't come to you yet. He says, therefore, in verse 11, let us be diligent to enter that rest. If you are a non-believer, if you are riding the fence, be diligent. That's important. That's an earnest. He's pleading with you. Be diligent to enter that rest. example of disobedience. The same example of disobedience is the example that the Israelites have put upon us, that of their unbelief and not being able to enter into the land of rest, the promised land. Now, it gets interesting. It gets really interesting here. It says here, and then we use this for the Word of God, we use this for the Bible, but I want you to see something about this. It says, for the Word of God, remember God spoke. God spoke. He's given us a salvation plan. He's revealed himself, who he is, and he's saying the Word of God. The Word of God goes out. Yes, it is the Bible, but yes, it is his Word. It is the gospel that has gone out, his salvation plan. He says the Word of God is living and active and sharper than any two-edged sword. The piercing, and it pierces as far as the division of the soul and the spirit, of both joints and marrow, and able, here it is, to judge the thoughts and intentions of the heart. Real quick, I want you to turn to John 12. John 12, 47. Matthew, Mark, Luke, John, and 12, 47. He says, if anyone hears my sayings, this is Jesus speaking. If anyone hears my sayings and does not keep them, I do not judge him. I do not judge him. This is Jesus talking. For I did not come to judge the world, but to save the world. He who rejects me and does not receive my sayings has one who judges him. The Word I spoke is what will judge him at the last day. The Word that I spoke is what will judge him at the last day. For I did not speak on my own initiative, but the Father himself who sent me has given me a commandment as to what to say and what to speak. I know that his commandment is eternal life. Therefore, the things I speak just as the Father has told me. But what it is the Word. It's the Word. It's salvation. He's given us the eternal life. He's saying, here's eternal life. Here's salvation. All you have to do is believe. And if you don't believe, that Word pierces you. In the final day, this is a day of judgment. This is a day that you will be judged by the Word. 1 Peter 2:8 says, talking about Jesus being the cornerstone, the stone which the builders rejected and became the very cornerstone. And the stone of stumbling and a rock of offense, for they stumble because they are disobedient to the Word. And to this doom they were also appointed. You see, it's the Word of God. This is a judgment here. It's not talking about that the Word of God pierces you what it does is it brings judgment to you. It brings judgment to you. And when you're standing there on the last day, and you're standing before God, those eyes are going to pierce through you. And he's going to look right into your heart. This is truth, my friends. God doesn't look at your works. He doesn't look at the outside. He pierces through you with his Word. And he looks at your heart. Is it a heart of belief, or is it a heart of unbelief? Simple as that. That's salvation for you. God is going to look in your heart and see unbelief or belief. We can sit here and play in church all day long, but I don't know your heart. I don't know your heart. I don't know what you say in your mind as you're looking at me. I don't know what you're thinking about other people. I don't know the plans that you scheme and things like that. I don't know these things that happen. I don't know your heart. But there is one who does. It's the Word. Either you believe or you don't. The Word came to you. The gospel has come to you. Either you believe simple. The gospel doesn't get much simpler than that. Either you trust in him or you don't. But here's the thing. You will be judged by the word of God. The word of God will pierce you and it will see your heart. And there will no creature hidden from his sight, but all things are open and laid bare to the eyes of him with whom we have to do. Scary thought. You should think about that. That is scary for those who don't believe that you're going to have this piercing one who looks at you, looks at your heart, and you're not going to be able to hide anything. There is no creature hidden from his sight, but all things are open and laid bare to the eyes of him. I think about one who Jesus talks of a parable of this guy who comes into the party, right, the wedding party, and he's not wearing the garment that he should be wearing. And he comes up to him and he says, "Friend, how did you get in here?" And it says that the guy was speechless. God was speechless because he has the one who looks at his heart. He sees the one who looks at his heart and says, "You are uncovered. You're uncovered. Your shame is here, standing before everybody. This is you." And then he says, "Take him out into the outer darkness where there's wailing and gnashing of teeth." That's a scary thing, people. You're not going to be able to clothe yourself the way you want to clothe yourself. "Oh, look at me and my works. Here it is." No, God looks right at your heart and says, "I don't care about your works. I don't care what you've done. Do you believe or you don't believe? Do you believe or you don't believe?" That's it. He says, "Therefore, since we have a great high priest who has passed through the heavens, Jesus, the Son of God, let us hold fast our confession." Let us hold fast that confession. What is that confession? Jesus Christ. If you proclaim him as Lord, if you confess him as Lord, and that God, and believe in your heart that God has raised him from the dead, you will be saved. This is the confession that we hold to. This is what we hold to. "For we do not have a high priest who cannot sympathize with our weakness, but one who has been tempted in all things as we are, yet without sin. Therefore, let us draw near with confidence to the throne of grace, so that we may receive mercy and find grace to help in time of need." Now, we're going to talk about that a little next week, and then we're going to jump into chapter 5. But I want you to see that. I wanted you to see that it's Jesus Christ who is the one we come through. It's Jesus Christ who is the one who is the mediator, the one that we pray to, the one that we believe in, the one that we hold our confidence in, our assurance, our hope, and everything. Consider Jesus. Consider Jesus. He's our high priest. He is the one who we're able to go to God through. We're able to go with confidence to God in the throne room. And proclaim how great you are. To be holy and blameless before him. Praise God. The children of God, praise him for that. Praise him that he sent somebody that we're able to have a relationship with the Father. The one who is life itself. He doesn't just give life. He is life. He's rest. He's everything. And then we go to him, we hold on to him, we hold fast to him because he's the only one. He's the only one that will get us to the Father. Our high priest, our great and mighty high priest, we hold to him. We hold fast to that faith and that confession that we have. We lay ourselves aside and we hold to him. My friends, hold to him. Those who believe, hold to him. Hold fast to him. Grow in strength. Grow in faith. Your faith should be growing. It did with the disciples. They saw wondrous works and they had very little faith. But then eventually, they had this great faith where they would even lay down their lives. They would lay down their lives to go and tell people of Jesus. That's an amazing thing. That's what I want to see here. I want to see that in each and every one of you. I don't want you to get uncomfortable when talking about Jesus. Talking about the one who saved you, the one who died for you. Oh, I'm a little uncomfortable talking about Jesus to anyone. Oh, they may get offended. It's sad. This one died for you so you could have rest with God the Father. And yet we hold back. Oh, I can't talk to anybody. I can't give anybody a gospel tract. I can't go in here and speak to anyone about Jesus because of, I just don't want to offend anybody. I think it's a relationship thing. I think they should see how I act, and then they'll come to Jesus. Well, it doesn't work that way. They're not going to see you. They need to hear it. They're the call. You're the call. To be called is to somebody speak to you. The word is spoken to you. And you hear it, and you receive it, and you believe it, and you trust it. Or you don't believe it, and you throw it to the side. That's the way it is, people. It's that simple. It really is that simple. And we make it so difficult. Either you believe or you don't believe. Father in heaven, I trust that you have spoken your word to the people. Father, I pray that you will continue to work through the people. People here and people who are hearing, that they will hear the gospel, they will hear the truth of who you are, and that they will come to faith, that they will come to believing in your promises and everything that you have given them through your Son, Jesus Christ. That's what we hold on to, Lord, and that's what I'm holding on to. I don't hold on to anything else, because everything else will disappoint me. This government, this world, or anything. But Lord, I hang on to you, because you never disappoint. So, Father, I pray that you will continue to work in my life and work in the people's lives here. I pray that they will be a light to the world, that they will go out with boldness and with great faith and proclaim how great you are through your Son, Jesus Christ. Those who don't know you, Father, I pray that they will hear your voice and come to you, that they will ask questions, that they will get it right, that they will not fall short, that they will not drift away, that they hold fast, that they will anchor themselves to you, Lord, and that's what I want for them. So, Father, I pray that you will do this in your mighty name, in the power of the gospel, in the power of Jesus Christ. And we come to you in the name of Jesus Christ, the great and mighty Savior. Amen. All right, Sandy Grange. I love you. I pray that you will go out into the world and proclaim this great news that has been proclaimed to us, this good news, this rest that we have that's coming, that is here, that's offered to you today. And so I pray that you will go out and proclaim that rest is given to all. And I love you and thank you for coming. Again, congratulations. A great and mighty feat. And so we are very proud of you. And so, again, thank you so much. Have a great week. We love you. And if you have any questions, let us know.
Wednesday night service.
That's right. Don't forget Wednesday night, 6:55. We'll see you.